It would be an understatement to say that my next guest is a man of many talents, one of India's most prominent voices around the country's diplomatic relations, a key anchor in strengthening Indo-Japanese relationship, someone who is fluent in more languages you can count on your fingers. Please welcome Mr. Sujan Chinoy, a career diplomat, currently serving as Director General of Manohar Parrikar Institute of Defense Studies and Analysis, to the next episode of Duologues, where we discuss business, life, purpose, and leadership. So thank you so much for agreeing to do Duologues with me, and I'm extremely thankful for you sparing time for this. We see very clearly that the world order is kind of witnessing a change. How do you see the world order evolving as of today, and where do you see India finding its own position in the time ahead?
Well, thank you, Manish, first of all, for inviting me to your wonderful show. The world was already in flux, rapidly changing environment, both geostrategic and geoeconomic, and we were aware of the fact that the main factors or vectors in globalization were already under stress. So I would cite here, for instance, trade, technology, finance, particularly developmental finance required by a very large number of developing countries, as well as human resources. Now we can see that the weaponization of trade and technology, especially the rift that took place between the United States of America, that is the world's largest economy, and the People's Republic of China, that is the world's second largest economy. So today there is a great deal of a struggle for kind of putting across the validity of a particular narrative. And we see this coming out of all the major sort of powers, so to speak, both political and economic. On the one hand, there is the liberal trading order, the democratic world, so to speak, that stands for openness and transparency, rules-based international order, democracy, human rights, so to speak. On the other hand, you have a China that is pushing across its own narrative, which is a kind of unique narrative with Chinese characteristics, just as you have socialism with Chinese characteristics, or in a sense, capitalism with Chinese characteristics. For the Chinese have a form of state capitalism. So in this case, the narrative is now what I refer to as the struggle for tenets. And there is also a disturbing trend today in evidence over territory. So it's not just trade and technology, it's not just developmental finance or the movement around the world in the global economy of human resources that are under stress, but also the area in which we deal with value systems and narratives and tenets that's under stress. And geography is also being tested through territorial disputes, many of which are historical in nature. True. And they have come up, they are brimming up to the surface. We have seen that in the East China Sea, in the South China Sea. We have seen it more recently in the context of the tensions in the Himalayas, right, in Eastern Ladakh.
Right.
So this is a moment in which power is fragmented. A new equilibrium is yet to emerge. And when all the pieces fall into place, we have to ensure that the world that emerges is still an equitable world, a world in which the norms of justice are not subject to interpretation, that there is a universal consensus on some of the basics, and which is that any form of globalization that emerges will have to be inclusive. It will have to be strong enough to prevent the gaming of the system to the advantage of a few. It will have to be a world in which the voices of the developing countries are heard adequately. And that is the world that is more likely to be a sustainable world order.
So in line with this, sir, while there are many facets of India's foreign policy, and as I heard one of your talks mention about the prerequisites as sort of laid out by our Honorable Prime Minister, where you mentioned that the very basis of our international relationship should be Samman, Samvad, Sahyog, Shanti and Samriddhi. How do you reflect upon, in this very backdrop of what you mentioned, India should find its own position in the international arena?
Look, you know, India is an ancient country with a very ancient civilization. It has its own ethos. It has its own value system. We were, as you are aware, the first to give to the world the notion of peace and non-violence as a philosophy. And to that, we have the added legacy of Mahatma Gandhi, again, about peace and non-violence, but also emphasizing satya, as in principles. So therefore, I think India is very well placed today in view of its long-practiced philosophy of peace and non-violence based on principles to actually emerge as a Vishwa Guru. And I think the Prime Minister, Sri Narendra Modi, has epitomized these values in terms of his own articulation of India's foreign policy, one that involves dialogue with the rest of the world, with mutual respect, the ability to help others without being focused entirely on one's own self, and to ensure that there is peace maintained as a prerequisite for giving full play to the developmental impulse, and also ensuring that there is prosperity for all.
Clearly, we have our national priorities, and while we are living with those national priorities and dealing with what it takes to meet those priorities, we are also finding our own place in the world. And the clarion call of Honorable Prime Minister, which is creating Atmanirbhar Bharat, a self-reliant India, what is your understanding of this narrative called Atmanirbhar Bharat, and how in this whole process we are going to balance out the national priorities and also our international priorities?
That's a very important question. For me, Atmanirbhar Bharat means essentially a very strong and resilient India. Atmanirbharta does not mean isolation. Atmanirbharta does not mean the kind of policy that was followed in the extreme example of, for instance, North Korea, which had and has a policy called Juche, which is also, tantamount to a policy of self-reliance. For us, Atmanirbharta does not mean disengagement from the rest of the world. It means engagement on our own terms. It means that we give ourselves a chance to play to our strengths, that where there is potential which can be explored and fulfilled, that we will give ourselves the ability to play on a level playing field, to ensure that we can actually stimulate the impulses that are readily available at home, the enormous capital that we have, not just in terms of monetary resources available to various parts of our economy, but also the human resources, and that we allow these to come to the fore and play their rightful role in global supply chains as well. So for me, Atmanirbharta is a very basic, essential ingredient for us to build a strong economic and social foundation. Now, for instance, people say that Atmanirbhar Bharat means that India no longer wants to be a big trading power. It no longer wants to engage others. It wants to close its doors to foreign investment and foreign participation in the Indian economy. Nothing could be further from the truth. When we speak of, for instance, developing India's place appropriately in global supply chains, what we mean is that we examine our strengths, we do a SWOT analysis of what kind of strengths we have in the Indian economy, and then decide if we have the capacities and the technologies, then we allow our people the opportunity to manufacture such things in India. Now I'm reminded of what Albert Einstein said, that if you, you know, judge a fish by its ability to climb a tree, it will forever believe that it is stupid. So, you know, we must play to our strengths.
Right.
We have the ability to innovate technologies, going beyond simply this oft referred, but rather simplistic notion of jugaad.
Right.
This is not a cut and paste, you know, innovation that we are capable of. Mm-hmm. We are capable of much more. So given the right opportunity and pointed in the right direction, our private sector is enormously capable.
Absolutely.
Of making many things.
Yeah.
And we should do it. For the others are also doing it.
Yes.
China has a Made in China 2025 program.
Right.
It is also in a sense geared at enhancing China's own Atmanirbharta.
Yes.
But this time through a quantum technological jumps up the value chain, moving from simply being a manufacturer, a center for manufacturing for the rest of the world, to going up to the next stage in terms of technologies.
Yeah, why not? So I think we are looking at good times ahead, because clearly this situation is definitely not sustainable, that we are importing the components and doing mere assemblies in the country. And I for sure can say that industry has understood its responsibility. While in the past service sector or the software sector was definitely making sure to utilize the opportunities even outside our country to export those services and software, it is time now that at least the manufacturing industry, especially for the electronic goods and those kind of products, starts to backward integrate and ensures that the component manufacturing also starts to happen in the country, and hence larger job creation and hence prosperity. So I think the direction is clearly defined and we are taking those steps in the right direction now. Yeah.
See, it's also a very good thing that you know, countries like India, Japan and Australia are working together in building resilient supply chains.
True.
So this is very important that we build together resilient supply chains, getting into this business of building resilient supply chains, having what we call alternative centers, and having what we call a certain risk mitigation strategy for supply chains is vital to the future.
Yes, that is true. And on the other hand, we are also looking at unlocking the true potential also. And as you rightly mentioned, you know, we had a very methodical approach, and I must compliment the efforts of Government of India, because as they say that leaders are able to identify opportunities in the situation of crisis. I mentioned that while the dialogue always was very consistent, but it immediately went very deep and objective, and empowered committee called Scale Committee was immediately formed under the leadership of Dr. Pavan Goenka. And the idea was to identify specific sectors where we have huge opportunity to tick couple of boxes. The most important is how do we backward integrate and ensure that we don't do mere assemblies and bring in component manufacturing here. And thankfully, three sectors were given to the FICCI's Electronics Committee, which I am responsible for. So first one is electronic components, huge. There is so much of potential. And then we sort of clarified which are the components we should be focusing upon. Second is air conditioners. And today we have the production linked incentive schemes also announced for those product categories. And third is televisions. And apart from this, there were categories like drones. And we were incidentally also discussing, and I'll now come to my fourth question, because there is so much of the softer aspects of the power which India possesses, the kind of legacy we have, the kind of heritage we have. And clearly, Ayurveda and yoga are ensuring that we find our own softer position in power. How do we ensure that we do a better justice to the Indian cuisine to be taken to the world and ensure that it finds its own position in the world? So I would request your reflections on that also.
India has much more to offer. As you know, we have a very rich civilization, and our heritage of yoga and Ayurveda is also something that we share with the rest of the world. In fact, in many, many parts of the world, yoga has also taken on you know, local roots, and people practice it in the remotest corners of the world in order to ensure their physical and mental you know, well-being. And more so, it is relevant today as we go through this unprecedented challenge. I think it is time for us to recall the great initiative taken by Prime Minister Narendra Modi, you know, took over as the Prime Minister, one of the first things he had done was to propose to the United Nations that there be an International Yoga Day. And the international community did adopt a resolution at the United Nations, and we do have an International Yoga Day.
Absolutely.
And so that's a huge plus for sharing our heritage with the rest of the world.
Right.
It's also not something that we're introducing to the world for the first time. I mean, take the example of our region and even countries like China and Japan and Korea. We have, through Buddhism and Hinduism, shared with these countries in the past yoga as well.
True.
Dhyan meditation from India became Chan meditation in China and eventually went to Japan and is known as Zen meditation. So Zen meditation in Japan, you are aware, given your interest in Japan, which I share
yes.
with you, that in Japan there is the very popular figure of Bodhidharma.
Yes.
Known in Japan as Daruma.
Absolutely.
Bodhidharma, who came from the Mamallapuram region of Tamil Nadu, went to China and founded the Shaolin school of Dhyan meditation. And he never went to Japan, but his followers took that body of thought and practice to Japan. As for Ayurveda, I have a personal interest in Ayurveda, but in our family,
yes,
on my mother's side, my mother's maternal grandfather had started in the 1880s a very well-known global Ayurveda company called Atank Nigrah Pharmacy. It was based out of Jamnagar, and it had branches in those days already in places such as Rangoon, in Kuala Lumpur, in Penang, in Colombo, in Karachi, and of course in India, in all the large cities. And it's not for nothing that the power of, for instance, turmeric,
right,
so evident in Ayurvedic products, is today spoken of as one of the elixirs for strengthening your immune system. There are so many that we find. I'm very happy to tell you that during my time as ambassador in Japan, we actually got the first memorandum of cooperation and understanding signed between India and Japan at the provincial level for cooperation in Ayurveda as well.
Excellent.
And so that was a huge achievement for us.
So during those days when you were kind of growing up and you were into school and then into college, there were few career choices during those days. Even in my times, I mean, there were few. So you could decide to become a doctor or an engineer. What inspired you, or who inspired you to take up foreign services in specific?
Well, that's a good question. But in my case, it was my mother, who, Usha Chinoy, my dear mother, late mother, she greatly inspired me to join the Indian Foreign Service. And my father was in the Indian Police Service. But I recall that from a very early age, I must have been 4 or 5, perhaps less, I would hear her telling me often that you must grow up and join the Indian Foreign Service, not the Indian Administrative Service or the Indian Police Service. So by the time I was 6, let me tell you very frankly, I had already decided that I will grow up and become a diplomat and join the Indian Foreign Service. Now, it's easier said than done, as you are aware, for you have to go through the rigorous process of preparing for the Union Public Service Commission examinations and rely on your hard work and a bit of luck to eventually get in, and also to get the service of your choice, as was the case with me. But I had still decided at the age of 6 that there was no other career option for me. And I stuck to that. I never wavered. But one of the reasons was also that I was extremely fond of and curious about the world beyond India. I was a voracious reader. I loved learning about the external world. So as life went on, I was curious. I wanted to learn foreign languages. I went to university and I always sought out the foreigners and tried to communicate with them in their languages. Likewise, I studied German. I did a diploma in German early on in the first 2 years of my university in Baroda. I taught myself French and Japanese in those days through the medium of lingua phones. I used to spend a lot of money buying different lingua phones. And I was the only one when I went to Ahmedabad for my master's to be enrolled for a course in Arabic. I've always believed that it's very important to learn languages, for they allow you to reach out to different people. And in fact, at the heart of this principle of Vasudeva Kutumbakam should be the ability to communicate.
True.
Because that allows you to understand thought processes. It allows you to see what are the cultural moorings, the value systems that actually drive a certain thought process.
You've had strategic responsibilities into various countries in the past, and I'm sure you would have gone through a variety of experiences. Are there some experiences which have kind of stayed with you, which were kind of enriching, or situations of managing a crisis of a sort?
I've always learned something new every day. And so I cannot say that I did a job perfectly, for that would be too presumptuous. But I can always say that I tried my best to learn perfectly on every job and to contribute as best as I could. Now, one thing that I learned early on from the Japanese, quality of being able to take, you know, all the, you know, the bumps alongside the smooth ride. So the rough patches have to be, you know, taken with equanimity, without losing your equilibrium. For you can always live to fight another day, and to, you know, respect others. So these are things that have stayed with me. I learned things from my stay in China as well, but I could see that the Chinese were a very hardworking people, extremely hardworking, wanting to improve their lot on a daily basis. I could see from the Australians that they were willing to give a fair go to everyone, the sportsman spirit. From the Mexicans, I learned the importance that they give, like we do, to family, to, you know, our cultural heritage, to being friendly and hospitable to others, something we share greatly with the Mexicans. So there's something you learn from everyone. In my career, no country has been an exception.
True.
They all taught me something.
The first time I met you was in Japan, sir, and I myself, in my professional responsibilities, I visited Japan more than 100 times, I believe. And every time I visit Japan, there is something to learn. You also mentioned some of those aspects. Is there a commonality between two countries, the kind of culture which cuts across, or the philosophies which we believe in, the legacy which we have created for our countries? I mean, is there a commonality which makes these two great countries natural friends, natural allies?
Yes, I think one of the great things that we share with Japan is the desire for peace.
Right.
Both India and Japan have this undercurrent of the value of peace. Now, this is not to say that you know, India or Japan cannot rise to the occasion to defend itself in more warlike manner,
right,
as a dharma. Hmm. And in the case of India and Japan, you know it as well as I do, that we make a very good fit.
Yeah.
For India has vast human resources. Japan has an aging population. Japan has technologies and innovation. India also has considerable, you know, technological prowess and capacity for innovation. And so if we can only bring together our strengths and the strengths of Japan, you know, our software capabilities, their technological capabilities, their you know, financial and other resources, they sit atop a heap of untouched finance, as you know, running into trillions of dollars. And if we can combine that with a capacity that India has to emerge as a manufacturing center for the rest of the world, we can do a great deal together.
We clearly know that you are a man of many talents and you are leading a very important responsibility. And I understand that you have interests not only into languages, but also into music, into sports, into fitness. How do you juggle between your personal passions and your professional responsibility? How do you manage your time and energy?
Well, I think all of us can do that, you know, bring about a certain balance and harmony in our lives. It's a decision which others cannot take for us.
Yeah.
We have to decide for ourselves what that priority is. So for me, I have always wanted to, you know, keep fit. And I love sports. I still love my horseback riding. As a young man, I used to do a fair bit of tent pegging, which is, I would say, a fairly adventurous sport, a bit of show jumping. But now I confine myself to a more sedate pace, just riding, you know. I love swimming. I love sports, tennis, if given an opportunity. I like to work out in a gym, but I like the great outdoors. And the one great thing that is available to us in the cantonment is to go up to Upper Shankar Vihar on the Philora Nature Trail and experience nature there. So I love doing that. Music has always been part of my life, but I've never really found as much time for it as I would have like to.
You used to play sitar, I understand.
Yes, so music runs in the family. For my father, I think wielded the gun and the sitar with equal ease. He could switch from one. He was a great shot. And he played the sitar very well. My mother was a well-known musician. And many of her, you know, sort of songs, traditional Gujarati songs, Lok Sangeet, as they are known as, or ghazals. These are available on YouTube. So music was in the family. My sisters were very good vocalists, both of them, my elder sisters. And so I ended up playing the sitar from a very early age. And throughout school, I was the lead sitar player in the orchestra at the Rajkumar College in Rajkot. I won the music prize for several years in a row. But in Mexico, in 2013, I challenged myself to bring out my father's old sitar, and I actually gave a public performance. I played on the sitar two of Gandhiji's favorite bhajans, that is Vaishnava Janato and Raghupati Raghav Raja Ram. So I did this after considerable practice, and I got away with it.
So would you like to also share your experience acting in a movie?
Well, this is a long time ago when I had a full crop of hair and I was young, like you are. This was the year 1980. And I spent a lot of time riding in those days. So there was a filmmaker called A.K. Nadiadwala. Mm-hmm. He happened to know my dad. So he one day saw me. And he asked my father, who's this man? So my father said, he's my son, preparing for the UPSC exams. He turns to my dad and says, horse riding, beard, can he come with me to Halol Studios and spend a day or two? So my father said, what for? And he said, I think I have a role in mind for him. So this was the film, Surat No Si Chelbai. Now, the funny part of this was that they asked me to obviously die and remove myself from the movie. And so when I was stabbed, being a fit, 21-year-old, I kind of spun around a little bit, leaned back. I was very good at reaching for the ground, you know, kind of a reverse flip, you know. And so I went back as much as I could, and then from about 3.5 feet, I just let myself go. So I crashed onto the ground. The turban came loose, and I was genuinely concussed. And so then I lay still, you know, kind of trying to come to my senses, but I'd obviously hit something hard in trying to give a very natural shot. When that shot ended and I was done and over with, they were again clapping and praising me. Ki saab kya badhiya shot diya aapne. Itna realistic tha. I said, that wasn't acting. I actually had passed out. So that brought to an end my illustrious acting career. But I never acted again.
But very inspiring. Thank you for sharing that, sir. This possibly brings me to my last question in the conversation. Is there a higher purpose which lets you do what you do? I mean, is there something which wakes you up every morning and keeps you energized? And I mean, what is your higher purpose in life?
So I don't know if I mentioned this to you before, but for me, I think the big driving force every day is to wake up and utilize the next 24 hours to the best of my abilities, to the fullest, to the brim. I want to not only do my best for myself, but also to try and do my best for others who depend on me. Now, this could be my family, but it should also include the larger family, that is society. We must all remember that dependency is ingrained.
Right.
That we all depend on one another. True. And so if we do our best for society, it is something that we should do without being called upon to do so as a duty. It must be in the everyday moment that we try and contribute to society. At the end of the day, when you put your head to the pillow and ask yourself, did I do my best for today? The answer should always be yes. And so that is the driving force for me.
Right.
I have a thirst for knowledge. I feel that there is so much that one doesn't know.
Sir, finally, I would request you for a message to the youth watching this video.
Believe in yourself. Respect your culture and your civilizational heritage. Always be open to learning. Never be judgmental. Never give up. Never compare yourselves to others. Each one of you is unique, and you can rise to the very top in whatever you do in life. Good luck and God bless.
Thank you so much, sir. This conversation has been really enriching and I would say insightful, very inspiring for me. And I'm sure everybody is going to gain a lot of insights and inspiration out of this conversation. Thank you for sharing your experiences, your life philosophies, and I wish you best of health, and please continue to keep safe, especially during these times.
Thank you very much, Manish, for this wonderful opportunity to unburden myself and to share a lot of thoughts with you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much.
It has been an honor to learn from a personality who has worn many hats professionally and yet has stayed true to his passions at the same time. That is what life should be about. Balance and keeping it simple. I look forward to your views in the comments section. Thanks for tuning in. I'll be back with the next episode of Duologue soon. Till then, stay safe, stay healthy.